Okay, welcome back from the CPEC. What I'm going to talk is hazard and risk assessment and their applications. And some of these things are probably talked by Dr. Vinod and also Dr. Paul. But I'll try to make it more in quantitative way, we do. So first of all, I'd like to tell you about the hazard, vulnerability, and exposure. So, and this definition is, of course, depending on the kind of people you talk. So if it is a sociologist, then they will bring capacity or mitigation information into this equation. But as an engineer, it's very difficult to define capacity. What is your capacity in terms of numbers? It's very difficult. So that's why I try to avoid that kind of terms in here. But if you can quantify capacity, you can bring it here. So if it's a hazard, so this is your river, and these are your flood, 5 years flood. This is a small one, or 100 year flood. So Dr. Paul already explained about this intensive and extensive hazard. So this small flood is the extensive hazard. Whereas a 100-year flood could be an intensive hazard, once in 100 years or something like Thailand we had in 2011. Then you have vulnerability. This is your flood depth, this side, and this is your damage for the, from the buildings. So if it is a very good quality buildings, RCC reinforced concrete building, even if your flood depth increases, your damages remain very low. Particularly double story, triple story building, because you can bring your things up and there will be not much structural damage in that. But if it's a very poor quality house, even little increase in flood that your damage is very high. So this is basically you do it in the field. And this one you do it in modeling and GIS. Dr. Guna already mentioned about flood modeling. And also you have this map or satellite data. You put this flood map on your satellite data, then this is your exposure, basically. That is what your exposure said. So your flood risk assessment is limited to this exposed area, basically. So I'll go through a little bit of definitions or concepts. So when we say the hazard here, so what is hazard in terms of quantified? So basically, this is a probability of happening something, say this building is coming down, this stone is coming down, what's the probability of coming down? So once you calculate the probability, that is your hazard. This is your elements of risk, buildings, infrastructure, people inside buildings. This is low vulnerability because this is a reinforced concrete, even this stone comes, it will be less damage than this. If stone comes, it's completely different. So it's a highly vulnerable. Then, this is high exposure because it's close to the source of a hazard. So if it is low exposure, because away from the hazard. So if there's a river, it's near the river, it's high exposure, basically. So just to this one, this hazard is nature side, we don't have any control when this guy comes down. Only we can calculate some probability. This is our side, vulnerability. If you bring if you build a very good house, high quality, good quality house, your vulnerability is less for earthquake or landslide or whatever. Then we calculate the risk in terms of hazard and exposure, vulnerability, and the amount means the economic the cost of the building. And this is the difference between risk and disaster. When we calculate the risk, we predict that if an earthquake or flood or this magnitude will come, then how much loss it can incur. But when you say disaster, it's already happened. Something happened and already happened. So if your risk calculation is correct, at the time of disaster, the damage or loss will be accurate to your this calculation basically. So, but this, since it is we are making something for the future, so that will be useful for your planning purposes, any mitigation measures or planning. So I'll go to an example. So this is a tree, this are the flood plain, this is the river itself, and this is a 10-year flood. Okay? And you have a 10-year flood means you expect once in 10 years, this is 1 by 10 probability. So that's 0.1, that is hazard. You have exposure, this is say normal exposure, this is high exposure because it's in the low-lying area. Water is up to the ceiling, so it's 1.2, and it is in the up ground, so the exposure is 0.8, 80% exposure. And vulnerability, this house is, you can expect 20% damage. This is up to the ceiling, so it has 100% damage, so it's 1. You can expect 50% is 0.5, and the value of this house, three houses, is 100,000. So you calculate the risk now. You see, this is carrying a cross expected damage if a 10-year flood happens of $5,000, $12,000, and $1,600. Total cost damage you expect is $18,600 of this intensity flood. Now, if you want to build a dam here, what is the cost of this dam? That's important. If you find that this cost of this dam is maybe $50,000, better not to build it here, because you are only saving $18,000. But that is not the case actually. It depends on the situation. If you say we have done some work in Bhutan last year in the one basin in the mountains, they only less than 10 houses are exposed to flood like this, if you put a wall like this. But still they insist that, they said that, they still say that a lot of agricultural fields are affected by flood in those areas. So they wanted to have this kind of dam by the community, but government is still not decided, because they think that they can save very little money putting so much of expenditure in the dams. But in case of cities, it is completely different ball game. If you see, say Bangkok, South Rai River, in 1995, there was a flood, and AIT was about to get flooded in 1995, but it did not happen. Then I think 96 JICA, Japan government came to and they offered I think $4 billion to Bangkok City, protect Bangkok City. And Thai government discussed a lot of 2-3 years they negotiated. Finally they said no, we can take care of ourselves, we don't need this money. 2011 flood happened. Do you know how much damage Bangkok City is? $45 billion. If had they invested that $4 billion in 1996, it could have been much of things could have been saved. Now, Thai government is putting $10 billion to protect Bangkok. Actually, it was, everything was done, but I think some because of political change, it's on hold right now. But they are going to build dike around the whole city, and also many other measures. So it will cost them $10 billion. It's their own money. So this is the actual scenario. So whenever we talk about disaster, we normally talk about cities. If there is a disaster in a city, if a flood which is happened in maybe in rural area, nobody talks about it. But 2 months back, there was a big flood in India, Chennai. Everybody talks about it because it is affecting so many infrastructure, so many things. And also, but if government doesn't want to do this, then you can probably do this way. So you can protect by yourself. If you do this kind of flood proofing, you have to spend up to 15 to 20% more than the total cost. So then you can make your things flood proof. But most important thing is this one. So, sorry. So here you can see this red area. This is a high risk area. So the government decided, okay, there should not be any settlement. So they moved the house out. This is medium risk. Maybe some limited settlement is allowed, and this is risk-free area. So this kind of land use planning. Is very, very important on basis of this kind of risk assessment. And you know, now Japan, they are talking about smart cities. India is talking about 100 new smart cities. I think this will play a very important role to make the city smart. Also, this is one of the most important exercise for the insurance company. If you are in high risk area, you insure your house, your premium is high. If you are in low risk area, premium is low. So many of the insurance companies does this exercise before they do the insurance. But sometimes they also do mistakes. So if you look at 2011 flood, insurance company came to Thailand first time for agricultural insurance in Thailand. You know how much loss they get without doing all these studies? 500% loss to them. And they wanted to withdraw actually from Thailand after 2011. But I think Thai government now subsidizing to keep them in the business. So these are the things, and this has a very high demand. There are not many risk assessment experts in this world, particularly developing country. Because this, I'll explain later more, because this risk we are talking about, not only one risk, we are talking about risk in the same area. Many risks can happen. For example, we are going to have a new project in India, which is same area. It was a 2013 big flood. It's called Uttarakhand. So we had the flood is there, but there is other risks also, like earthquake, then landslide, and also industry. So we have to organize this World Bank project for four different types of risk. So this kind of risk experts, you have to have an earthquake expert, you have to have a landslide expert, you have to have a flood expert, all together, combined together. So it's a very challenging thing. And but it is a market. So if you're trained in risk assessment, probably you will do very good. But the point here is, this is one scenario, sorry, but in reality it is not like this. You have flood of different level. So you have 10-year flood, you have some certain damage. If it goes to 50-year, your damage will increase. So you can, as your, for a 2-year flood, this house was not exposed, not vulnerable. But now if the 50-year flood, it is now exposed and vulnerable. So as your flood level increases, then your vulnerability changes. And you can see for 2-year return period, this kind of flood, these three houses, you are expecting $20,000. 10-year flood, $160,000. 50-year flood, $250,000. So that is what Dr. Paul said. If probability is one is a very small probability, but your damage is very high. So the probability goes less, like Japan earthquake, maybe 2011 earthquake and tsunami, maybe 1 to 400 years, maybe Dr. Navid can tell better. So on tsunami in 2004, which may be 1 in 300 or 400. So very small chance, but you can see the damage, very, very high damage. So now, the one which we are talking about is a deterministic, we determine the line, how much. But that is not a reality. That is a mistake I think Thailand did, because they have the 100-year flood. They have the 100-year flood risk map for this, and they are well prepared for that. But the 2011 flood probably takes 100 years, it's maybe 150 years. Then your environments are coupled, and then you can see how much devastation happening. So this is what we call probabilistic. So all these scenario you have. Now you have to decide. You have to decide now where you want, how much you want to protect. For as I said, for Bangkok, it was 100 years. So they make the protect environment for 100 years. For Netherlands, is under the, below the sea level, this line in the western side is 1,250 years. Because if they don't invest that one, when the sea water will come in and go for the country. So they have money, they have technology, and they have done that one. So this is really depend on how much resources you have. And many countries, World Bank is helping now to raise this kind of scenario. The second thing is you need to also need a very detailed information from these buildings or about these buildings. And you know, data is a very, very difficult thing. Now, crowdsourcing is one option. So you can see something in Google Map here. You can see, but there is not very detailed information, but very similar to Google Map, it is called OpenStreetMap. The background image is from Microsoft Bing Map. You can digitize their houses and you can put in the map, and it is open to everybody in the world, actually. But Google Map, you cannot do that. You can digitize, but you can use for yourself only. You cannot make it public. But this allows you to make it public. And we are trying to use this kind of information. We have a project currently with Asian Development Bank. So from our OpenStreetMap, we get a satellite image. Then we transfer this information to the OpenStreetMap. Then it goes to a data management system, and then it downloaded to mobile phone. We are developing the mobile phone applications right now. Then this all building footprints, you see, it is in your mobile phone. And anybody can download in the community, and then they can go to the house. Okay, this is AIT center. They put down an AIT center. How many levels of two levels? How many rooms are there? How many people are living here? How old this building is? So that kind of information will be coming from the public now and going to the system, and it will be kept for future use. So I'll explain that one a little bit later. Also, this kind of crowdsourcing information is very, very useful. If you look at the 2013 or 2014, the Haiyan. So this is the path. And after the disaster, this is the situation. Nobody knows how many houses were damaged, how many people were there. So then ADB asked Philippines government, what's your damage? So this is the situation. Then ADB employed some mappers from OpenStreetMap. It's all volunteers. And from satellite data, they map all these buildings, you can see. And from red one is, I think, very badly damaged. And then once you have this kind of information, you can tell, okay, 100,000 buildings damaged, then this is probably our loss. Then you can ask for the donors to help. So this is becoming increasingly popular. And after this, actually, after this event, ADB has come up with this new tactical assistance project, which AIT got it in Armenia, Bangladesh, Philippines, and Fiji. Four regions: Central Asia, South Asia, Southeast Asia, and Pacific. I'll explain a little bit about that. So then also we are doing some risk assessment. In many countries, we are, this is in Sri Lanka. So we have the 20-year flood map, 50-year flood map, 100-year flood, all coming from models. Particular river resource, topography, and all those things, then we can model it. Then also, same flood event, we have some satellite data. And this black one is all flooded area. And we look at, compare, this is from our model, this is from the satellite. This is actually true. And this is, model is always model. This can never be reality unless you have, you can be close to the reality. But you need, particularly for flood, you need a very high quality digital elevation model. We don't, did not have, so probably it will not match it. But once, but it, this will give you an opportunity to improve the model from satellite data here. So then also we went to the field, vulnerability assessment. We interviewed the people, this house is flood is up to here. Then we develop some, this is hazard map, this is your vulnerability map for different type of houses, flood, depth and damage. Then also cost of the building, as in my example I have shown. Then we get a risk map. And you see, this is hazard map and risk map is little shrink. And you can, the dark areas probably you can expect very high damage or loss. So the one important issue is here, you see, this is flood map or flood hazard map, and you see there is a lot of flood in this area, but not much risk, because many in the mostly developing countries, around 90% of work is they have flood maps, and they take decisions on basis of this hazard map. But even if you see, although there is not much flood, but you can say high damage, because there are high value buildings like factory or something is there. So if you want to do your planning in future for risk mitigation, if you do your mitigation on basis of this flood map, you are going to miss the target. You should have this one, and these red areas should be protected first, mitigated first, because then where you can even reduce your damages. So this is important. And also, this is again ADB project, Armenia, Bangladesh, Fiji, and Philippines. We are doing some innovative application of hazard maps for evacuation purposes. So this data is coming from satellite data, as I said, OpenStreetMap. They have also some community map. We are doing some program called Town Watching, work with a community. The community knows, okay, 2 years back there is a flood here, there is landslide there. So all of these are captured. And also we have some flood map coming from, as I said, some flood map is coming. And also then on basis of you put all together, and then you can define your evacuation route. If you know that there is a flood, if there is a road in this area, you should not take that road. So some evacuation planning can be done. And all these things put in your database, and people in the community, they can download to their mobile phone. If flood is coming, then they can, our application will help them to navigate. They can serve nearest shelter or nearest safe place. So this is what we are developing here in these 4 countries right now. And also, crisis mapping means you have this building information from the OpenStreetMap, which we have digitized. You have flood map from the satellite data, and you have cell phone with you. So what happened is all this data you go to the, with your mobile phone, you go to the field, then you can say, okay, this area, these are the buildings high damage, this building less damage, so this area needs some kind of say attention for relief. So all this information you can put in a mobile phone, and then you can create some this kind of map. And this, because you have the very detailed information about the building, you can assess the damage also from your database. Already you have some information. So, and you can create some crisis map for relief or response purposes by the government. So this is one thing. And third important thing also we are doing is, this is actually not hazard map, this is probably actually risk map. So you have some, original data from OpenStreetMap, you have some satellite data, you have a risk map. So then you can, with your mobile phone, you can go to the field, all data you can see which house is damaged more. This is actually, we did for Nepal earthquake. So you can see the red buildings are highly damaged by the earthquake. Yellow buildings are less damaged. So all these things are, will be now packaged in a mobile phone. So people can, and once they use our mobile phone application, they update the information, immediately it will be updated in our server here in AIT. So this project is for pilot 4 countries, but we have a plan to work in many other countries. So this is what we are doing right now. And also regarding risk, this is one initiative called CAPRA, Comprehensive Approach for Probabilistic Risk Assessment by World Bank. And here, there's a city, is high risk area, this is low risk area. So if you want to take a loan from a bank to set up an industry, they will like to see that you are in a safe area. If you put your factory in a high-risk area, you have to pay high premium for the insurance or something like that. Or if there is a money coming from government to invest, so they can, if you have risk, that you know where to put your money. And also people like you and me, also we want to know where we are. But this is, of course, not very valid for developing countries because we have too many people, less scarcity or high scarcity of land. But in case of developed country, if there's a high risk area, land prices goes down. Okay, so this is one important. And as I said in the beginning, that this risk assessment, this city, it may be not only for one risk. It may be flood, it may be hurricane, it could be earthquake, it could be landslide, or it could be tsunami. So you have to calculate the risk for all the hazards together. And this platform, CAPRA, will provide you this platform for six hazards together. And in fact, we have just got a project from World Bank in India, Dehradun, as I said, and we are using CAPRA for this particular World Bank project in India, which we are starting maybe next month. So, also this is something, CAPRA, for hurricane, wind and storm. Hurricane has two components. One is it can be damaged by wind, it can be damaged by storm surge. So if we could model, they could model both, and you can see the red houses are highly high risk, yellow is low risk from these two particular hazards. Also, this is at building level, or you can want to do your city, this kind of map. Probably these red areas you can restrict, saying that nobody should build, no settlement is allowed. And also maybe some of the yellow area may be limited settlement, controlled settlement, or green area maybe you can. So this kind of, as I said, the smart city concept, if you have this kind of maps, it will help you to build your city smart. And this is, I think, one of the World Bank is investing a lot on this kind of things. Many projects are coming up now on this assessment like this. And also our recent work, we have recently, last month, March, we have 2 months back, we finished flood hazard mapping in Bhutan, Nepal, and Vietnam, landslide in Indonesia and Sri Lanka. And this is the project we are starting maybe next month in Uttarakhand with DHI, Singapore, AIT, and the developer of CAPRA from Mexico. It's called ERN. So we are going to walk, and we will be walking for four hazards jointly together: earthquake, landslide, flood, and industrial hazards, all combined together, and we assess the combined risk. I think that's my last slide. Thank you very much.